Hello, Miss Coffee Bean always wanted to ask you, how old are you? Are you old enough to remember those times in computer vision when autoencoders used to be the big thing? If you remember this, then you are indeed a very old person in machine learning. So be happy, because guess what? Autoencoders are fashionable again in computer vision. This paper combines our favorite things: transformers, masking, autoencoding, and self-supervision in a beautifully written paper with a simple yet powerful idea. So welcome to this AI coffee break, where we will break down and explain the most important contributions of this paper. Ms. Coffee Bean, why did you bring a sponsor? Oh, because I was running out of coffee beans and needed money to buy some new ones. But don't worry, I would never use you to make my coffee. Okay, then here we are. This video was brought to you by Weights and Biases. If you haven't heard of Weights and Biases, then surely you are living under a pile of coffee beans. With Weights and Biases, you can track your experiments and have beautiful plots at the same time, reproduce your models, and optimize hyperparameters like a pro with sweeps. Say goodbye to your good old uninformed grid search and welcome their integrated Bayesian optimization. And no, you don't have to understand this magic to use it. There are two things I find especially impressive. First, you can integrate Weights and Biases with just a few lines of code, like look at this. And secondly, it's free for personal use, and it's also free for academic teams. Of course, the big players need paid plans, but if you are a student like me who wants to stay organized, even in the advent of the paper deadline when all your coffee beans are going crazy and everything's a mess and irreproducible from that chaotic Excel spreadsheet you use for tracking experiments, then you should give Weights and Biases a try. Great, now let's talk about how and why masked autoencoders are indeed scalable vision learners. Hey, Miss Coffee Bean, take it slow. Like, first, what's an autoencoder? Autoencoders back in the day were reconstructing the input while being constrained to encode the input into a lower dimensional space, then reconstruct the input again, enforced by an L2 loss, a simple distance metric between input and output. And because of the bottleneck in the middle reducing the dimensionality of the data, the hidden space is a compressed, meaningfully packed and efficiently packed version of the input. Or in other words, ideally the data manifold is learned. So ideally, semantically similar points are close to each other in this space. And autoencoders worked well in computer vision where the image space is continuous, but were not as successful in NLP. One of the reasons is the discrete nature of text. Even if we often pretend that text isn't discrete by representing words as vectors in word embeddings, the in-betweenness of words, the interpolation of especially contextless words, is often not that straightforward in the same sense it is for the visual modality. And this is generating problems when trying to learn the data manifold in the code space. This then further causes problems when computing a continuous reconstruction loss in what is naturally a discrete space. But then everything changed with the introduction of transformers doing masked autoencoding, which happened first for NLP. Think about BERT, which is doing what a masked autoencoder does. It corrupts a portion of the data, usually 15% of the tokens, and BERT learns to predict the missing content by classifying which of all 30,000 or more tokens in the English vocabulary could have been the right word instead of the masked token. And we would like to do this autoencoding also for visual data, because think about it this way: a system that encodes data to decode it again not only has the advantage of self-supervision, that you do not need labeled data because you just take the input and reconstruct it, but it also learns more general representations of that modality. Because self-supervision means that the model is not allowed to forget everything that is not relevant for the label of that data sample, as it is the case in supervised learning, but needs to remember the essence of that data point to reconstruct the entire data sample. Only, you see, mass autoencoding, which since birth and its like was made easy for NLP, is now hard for computer vision. The authors highlight three key differences between vision and language. The visual backbones used as encoders for autoencoders were not ready yet in the era of CNNs. Convolutional-based backbones rely on the data regularity of image grids and is not easy to mask things out without introducing artifacts in the outputs of the convolutions. Secondly, vision and language are very different in terms of information density. A word is already a second-order abstraction of the world and compactly summarizes what otherwise is represented in many pixels in images. Also, information in images is much more smeared out because the neighborhood of some pixels speak very much about the masked-out thing. If we do not see the eyes of a dog, we still recognize the dog. Whereas in language, the context is not that verbose, and the crux of the information is mostly in the mask token. What does this mean? Well, while masking out 15% of tokens in language is already a lot, masking out 15% of the pixels is almost no corruption in images. And thirdly, the decoding procedure is more complicated for vision than for language. Predicting missing words is arguably easier because one predicts relatively little things with high semantic information. For this, just a multi-layer perceptron, or short MLP, suffices. But when predicting pixels, one must regress these many values, and while caring about maintaining contextual harmony between the many pixels, one pixel alone carries little semantic information, but the whole neighborhood of pixels means a lot. Therefore, it's not straightforward to do this whole autoencoding with transformers on images as it is on text, where the output is more compressed. Or well, it wasn't straightforward until this paper presented an elegant and simple solution. The recipe is: take the image and divide it into non-overlapping patches. This could be something like 16 times 16 patches. So far, we are exactly in the VIT setting. And we will stay in the VIT setting where every patch is transformed into one vector, even if this is not visualized right now in the video. But each patch here is a vector. To understand these prerequisites, please see our previous videos on the SWIN transformer, VIT and DIT, if you're not familiar with vision transformers in general. But now, instead of taking all these patch vectors as input, it's random masking time. And by masking, it's actually meant removing. Let's say 75% of the original number of patches are removed. Great, then the authors take the VIT encoder and encode only these remaining patches. But why did they remove the patches instead of just masking them? Well, because the authors are using a transformer as an encoder. They could have taken all image tokens, including the masked out ones bearing the value of the mask token, but that would blow up the sequence length, thus compute time in memory, because then also masked tokens would need to be processed in self-attention and then by the feedforward layer in each transformer block. So because the authors reduced the sequence length in the image significantly by just removing 75% of the image tokens in the set, they now can use very large encoders by increasing the parameter number in the feedforward networks, greatly increasing the capacity of the encoder. But Miss Coffee Bean, they are completely removing intermediate patches like they never were there before. Isn't that confusing for the encoder? No, because these things are almost removed like they were not there before, because the positional embeddings still remember the fact that this patch is from the upper part of the image, this other one from the second row, so there are many positions missing there. The structure of the visual modality is still encoded in the positional embeddings. So the encoder with a small sequence length processes the input and encodes it into the latent space. And the output of the encoder has the same number of tokens as the input has, because the encoder is a transformer and that's how usually transformers work. But after training, it captures the image semantics much better. Okay, now it's time for decoding because we are in an autoencoder, and this is where the masked tokens are inserted again. because now, when reconstructing the original image, the transformer decoder must follow the transformer architecture, one vector per token in, one vector per token out. So, from the set of the ideally semantically structured latent space tokens and mask tokens, the decoder, which is also transformer, takes each token and computes something else, which is ideally the original image patches, or almost, because to reconstruct back from vectors to the output image, the authors again use a linear projection to map the last activations into the pixel space so that the output of the model is an image and the mean squared error can be computed. It's important to note that while the encoder can be very big in terms of number of parameters because its sequence length was significantly reduced by removing 75% of the tokens, the decoder operates on all patches, also on the masked ones, thus needs to be lightweight. And this was the masked transformer-based autoencoder. And look, the reconstructions look kind of blurry. And Ms. Coffee Bean thinks that 1-2 papers further, this will be working for higher resolution too. But you know, the reconstruction quality was not the goal of this masked autoencoder anyway, but the learned representations over here. Representations that are already rich from this simple masked autoencoding procedure and do not need contrastive learning where it's hard to choose good negative examples and needs image similarities or complicated augmentation methods like the competition uses, such as SimClear, MoCo, Dino, or Biol. These representations can be used for supervised tasks too, like ImageNet classification or object detection or semantic segmentation. For more, check out the paper. But what you need to know is that for using the learned representations for some other supervised tasks, possibly, one just has to remove the decoder, fine-tune some more task-specific layers, which is easy. But it also needs to run the quite heavyweight encoder on the unmasked image, so on the entire image. Ms. Coffee Bean, how large are your GPUs again? Just two more interesting takeaways and we're done here, Ms. Coffee Bean. As motivated in the beginning, while 15% masking in textual data is noisy enough, for images, masking more is better than masking less. And the masking ratio of 75% empirically has been shown by the authors to work very well. Also, random masking is better than regular masking, which makes sense because the model should have seen all possible combinations of masks and positions. Encodings or positions. And if you want to know even more about all this, read the paper and other similar papers. And while leaving, do not forget to like and subscribe. Okay, bye.